So while this is where the markets currently are, we keep asking whether there are opportunities or not. Let's check in with Shailendra Kumar, the director at Narnolia Financial Advisors, who's joining us on the show today. Great to have you with us. What's your sense as far as these markets are concerned? I keep asking as many experts as I can whether the downside seems capped, or you think that we are likely to see a bit of a reversal, and days like this perhaps should be used as opportunities to sell off some of these counters that don't look as promising as they did in the past. What's your take?
Yeah, Vikram. So the mood in the market is surely very pessimistic right now. You know, for the last 6-7 days, we have seen a very severe cut in the Nifty, and the, most of the larger cap also has fallen very sharply over the last 6-7 trading session. You know, once the news around the API getting more taxed on the derivative trades and as well as short term and long term, because, you know, out of most of the API, 1/3 is basically, you know, as a trust and IOP. That surely has dented a huge amount of sentiment. We were already reeling, you know, under the demand slowdown, liquidity crisis, etc. So the backdrop is surely pessimistic right now. My own sense is that the kind of valuation multiple we have traded in the last 4 or 5 years. So Nifty usually has traded between 17.5 to 21.5 times 1 year forward. I think largely that range will remain valid for the next year as well. But the 17.5 at a current 580-585 kind of a number for FY20 EPS, it still gives you 5-6-7% kind of a more downside from here. So that should one should keep in mind. As far as the opportunity goes, the, right now in the market, you know, one segment which I see is showing some kind of a resilience is primarily infra names. So infra names are showing some resilience. The other thing is, you know, basically one has to look at, we have seen a lot of corporate stress story, you know, a lot of company came out with a stress kind of a situation. You had G, you had many names, like it appears that the next a month and a half something positive will start happening around that story, which will be the key trigger along with RBI credit policy next week.
Right. So there are a few triggers here and there, but whether or not it can change the course of the markets, that's a huge question mark. The sentiment, like you pointed out, is quite weak. There is a certain sense of nervousness as well. Looking at macroeconomic conditions, it's not looking too promising. Of course, markets, after having given up those opening gains, PSU banks are the ones we are focusing on, where the worst hits are coming in trade today. Stocks are performing under pressure, and this is happening after those earnings have come in. Canara Bank, Syndicate Bank, Bank of India and Punjab National Bank are the other counters that are losing out as well from the public sector banking universe. We had a chance to speak about a whole host of mid-cap banks and managements is whom we've connected with. Here's a sense of what we're getting from them about the public sector banking universe, how they're looking ahead as far as the rest of 2020 is concerned. Listen into this.
There is improvement as far as the asset quality is concerned, and we are many accounts in pipeline for resolutions, and we are confident going forward Canara Bank will be making much better results than the Q1 what we have shown now. And provision coverage ratio, which is currently at 68, will definitely improve to 75 for March 20, and we are very confident that the profitability also will be more. On advances growth, we are projecting a growth of around 12-13% for current year, and we are on track, and the growth will be equally distributed between retail and corporate.
We have about 11% capital, which is quite well above the regulatory minimum. We have enough amount of growth capital left in us, because this 2,200 crore excess capital is sitting with us. We can easily grow with this around 25 to 30,000 crore based on the current composition of our risk-weighted assets. So we do not have capital constraint as of now, but we have plans to raise between 500 crores to 1,000 crore. We are projecting an total advances growth of around 15% as compared to the market median for the banking sector, between 12-16%. So during the first quarter, we were flattish. So during the next quarterly basis, we expect to grow around 5% every quarter. So that is the growth target.
All right. So, yes, they are trying to sound as positive as they possibly can in these conditions. But there's IDFC First Bank as well to consider by way of earnings. We had a chance to speak to the management there, V. Vaidyanathan, the managing director and CEO at IDFC First Bank. We spoke to him to understand the growth outlook. And this after posting the weak quarter they did, the higher provisioning has led to a 617 crore rupee loss as far as IDFC First is concerned. This is the word that came in from Mr. Vaidyanathan earlier.
From FY20 perspective, things are looking really very good for us. What's happening is that our retail book, which at the time of merger was about 36,000 crores, has crossed 44,000 crores now. That's a very strong jump of close to about 8,000 crores. On the CASA front, the CASA book at merger was 6,400 crores. That's already crossed 10,000 crores this quarter. So basically what's happening is that the incremental growth of CASA is very strong. CASA is up 64% year on year. The incremental growth of retail loans is very strong. It's up, like I said, 8,000 crores. So all incremental businesses are trending very well. Just think of this business as capital first business model on a bank platform. And if you think about it like that, then you see how powerful it can be. We have a current equity of about 70,500 crores. We have a headroom to raise debt to equity of about 8,000 crores. We plan to raise at least about 1,500 crores of Tier 2 capital before the end of this financial year.
Asset quality has declined for IDFC First Bank. You're seeing higher provisioning come in as well. We are listening to all these managements, and there are other numbers that are expected from the public sector banking universe. South Indian Bank, from the NBFCs, there is Groove Finance that we're expecting. Bajaj Finance has already posted numbers. FinServe numbers are expected. Shailendra, as far as earnings go, the quarter gone by, definitely not a great one for the entire financial universe. What's your broader sense? Do you think that as far as asset quality is concerned for the private banks, it's looking slightly better than what we are seeing in public sector banks? And if so, would you go with the regular names that most of the experts have been suggesting, like ICICI and Kotak Mahindra Bank, or would you still hold out?
See, Vikram, let's look at the PSU bank right now. I think most of the fall which is coming right in the market lately is more because of position unwinding. So after the budget, you had a big announcement of large capital infusion in PSU banks, and that, you know, a lot of trading position got built. So most what the fall that we are seeing right now is less fundamental, more to do with the market position unwinding. In the private sector space, now one very noticeable thing in the Q1 result is that the smaller private sector bank are into some kind of, you know, slowdown mode, I would say. The credit growth for those banks are not, you know, the kind of growth they used to command earlier, 20% plus kind of a loan growth, has tapered decidedly for, you know, names like DCB and other banks. And this is very understandable, you know, 2014-2018 period, when most of the larger banks were facing, you know, NPA issue, these smaller private banks were doing reasonably good because of a large amount of retail and a geography concentrated loan portfolio. Now with a larger name like HDFC, Axis and ICICI, which has become truly pan-India, so there is no such advantage of a smaller private sector bank in terms of being very concentrated in a geography and having some kind of edge in that geography. So that's one thing. Secondly, the kind of competition those regional private banks are facing from NBFC in terms of loan pricing appears very high. So the mid-sized private sector bank is not something which will give you a higher alpha in the next 1 year. Naturally, these larger names like HDFC, Axis and ICICI, which has crossed the, like in the corporate lending space, Axis and ICICI both, along with the PSU name like SBI, Bank of India, Bank of Baroda, I would say, has crossed the NPL cycle. The provisionings are very smart. Loan growth are starting to come for these names. So these larger names will do better than the mid names because the mid name doesn't have any unique, you know, mode right now in the business space.
Sure. Okay, all right. Shailendra, I'm just going to join the conversation here and just get right on to the counter that we're looking at very carefully here, which is the Tata Motors, because that has slipped ahead of those Q1 numbers. A weak quarter is seen on the back of a poor show, really, from the domestic as well as the Jaguar Land Rover verticals. Margins also are expected to decline sequentially, while JLR is also likely to report a 50 to 100 million pound forex loss. The person who's going to be contextualizing all of this is Hiral. She's standing by with more on the expectations and line numbers. What exactly exactly are we watching out for when it comes to this particular company, as well as, of course, the real weakness that we're anticipating out of Atamo at the moment?
That's right. So overall, if you go to see on a consensus basis as well, brokerages are expecting a massive loss on a consolidated basis. In fact, a loss number that is expected at JLR level as well as in terms of the domestic business as well, because both the businesses have been under pressure if you have to see their volume growth. Now, if you see the loss figure range as well, it's a wide range from almost around 1183 crores, which is moving up to almost 3550 odd crores on a consolidated basis. So that's bigger range that we have been working on moving from there on. If you go to see clearly the JLR wholesale numbers, that's excluding the Chinese JV, that is down around 4%, and Chinese business has seen a degrowth of almost around 34% during the quarter. Margins are also expected to decline on a sequential basis, and you're expecting JLR to report a 50 to 100 million pound forex loss as well. Now, in terms of the other highlights are concerned, geographical wise, UK is expected to see a growth of 2.6%. North America is weak. Europe, a degrowth of around 9%, where Brexit is playing its own role, which is impacting the European business. Chinese, again, a 29% is the kind of downtick that we've seen, and the overseas markets have seen a 20% growth. We should be watching out for the Chinese inventory situation, as well as the compliance with regards to Chinese EV norms, the demand and discounting trends, especially in terms of JLR's key markets and the FCF generation, because currently the FCF generation is negative. The anticipation is probably at the end of FY20 or at least in the beginning of FY21, there is a possibility that the company will turn FCF positive on the back of the downsizing that they have done in terms of their capex plans as well. On the standalone basis, a downtick of 20% on the revenue, a loss of 101 crores versus a profit number of 1187 crores is what we are watching out for. And you have the negative operating leverage as well as higher discounts that is putting pressure on the margins as well. So clearly, if you go to see, all eyes are now going to be as to what is going to be the exact loss number, what is going to be the strategy with regards to where free cash flow generation is concerned, and in terms of where demand trends go, how are they expected to meet that, taking the concerns in terms of the auto slowdown and the inventory buildup that's happening. But overall, the expectation is pretty weak from Tata Motors.
All right, Hiral, thanks for really telling us how one is going to be looking out for those numbers. So basically, you're looking at a preview whereby brokerages are expecting quite a massive set of losses on those subdued volumes as well. Shailendra, your quick take on Atamo, as well as any kind of observations you have for the industry at the moment?
See, Fatima, you know, one thing is there. Most of the auto names across the world, not only in India, they have seen a kind of a valuation derating over the last 2-3 years. Because everybody is expecting some kind of a disruption because of EV and autonomous vehicle, etc. So the valuation multiple for most of the names, all the global names, the valuation multiple has fallen continuously. Tata Motors surely has its own share of issue. You know, Chinese volumes are not picking up. You know, US market is fine. Europe has its own set of challenges. So I think it's better for an investor right now to buy some simpler auto stock. Simpler means one country focused stock, so maybe could be a name like Maruti. So whenever the things turn, and right now for sure nothing is positive, but whenever things turn, a company with a very light balance sheet, very simple business model and large market share will be able to, you know, do better in the when the next rally starts, could be in March 2020, instead of a complex company like Tata Motor, which is spread across geography, having challenges in most of the geography right now.
That does make sense as far as the auto play is concerned, because who's likely to gain more? Is it going to be one country focused company like a Maruti or Tata Motors, where the geographies are spread, and pretty much every quarter on quarter we see the impact of JLR play out on how Tata Motors does as a company, and things aren't clear exactly where it will go. But the market leader right now is Maruti, and the truth remains that the stock is available at 5,740 levels at today's date. So half a percentage point cut coming in. We'll see where it goes and how soon that turnaround happens. September, March 2020, we don't really know. But for the moment, this is what many experts are suggesting would be a good buy if you want to stick to the auto pack. Meanwhile, we have spoken about the infra universe, and perhaps there are a few opportunities that are buzzing over there. From the cement pack, subdued second quarter is more or less expected from Ambuja Cement. profits, sales, volumes, all of these are expected to slip this time. The company is expected to see a 30 basis point margin expansion though because of the firm cement prices that we've seen at least in the last few months. Let's connect with Piyush Jain, my colleague. He tracks the cement space very closely and he's here to break it all down for us. Piyush, where are expectations pegged on Ambuja Cement even as the stock is up around 6 tenths before those earnings are reported?
Well, Ambuja Cements, again, unlike ACC, which had the benefit of selling heavily in North India, also again got the benefit from South India sales, Ambuja perhaps again will have a distortion here. Again, selling more in Gujarat, Rajasthan had sand issues, then again will have to sell more in North India. But how many cement companies again can sell really and also take market share in North India? So that perhaps is going to be a wild card for the Ambuja results. If Ambuja was able to dispatch more in North India, more again in the Noida region, more in the Punjab region, then perhaps actually we could see a margin surprise here. Headline numbers are there on your screen. From the point of view expectations, a subdued quarter is expected. Again, a sales also again from the point of profit growth. This basically is primarily reflecting that activity on the Gujarat side, Rajasthan side was not again as strong as the pricing activity in extreme North India and also in the South India here. So perhaps this might not be similar fireworks with respect to like again the way ACC has provided. But again for Ambuja, what will be important here is it will still have benefit again of slightly stable pricing in the North India. Also the West India again, basically that was looking much better than Central India. This time also again the Central India is not going to provide it that sort of cushion which again for the last two quarters it has been providing. So the delta is if you sell more in North, then again you can outperform. Expectations are slightly on the lower side, but ACC has lifted the expectations. But at that, as we know again, it was primarily because of North India here. On the other side, on the freight fuel cost side, that basically largely has been benign. On the power cost side, again, that also again has been supported this quarter. So margins perhaps they largely hinge upon again how much volumes Ambuja actually will be able to sell here. So those perhaps will be the key points. On the other side, what are we going to expect from the management? Those will be some commentary around how's the demand looking like. There has been mild sort of 2-3% price cuts in the July month so far. But again, that basically is almost in line with the monsoon season. So again, if the pricing is actually the management's thinking, pricing is going to hold. Is the demand looking as strong as again basically is being expected? And that perhaps the street will like to know here. So as a summary, a subdued quarter. The surprise can only be if Ambuja is able to take market share in North similar to ACC.
Whether or not market share is going to improve for Ambuja vis-a-vis ACC, that remains to be seen in those numbers like Piyush is pointing out. But Shailendra, you did mention the infra pack. I don't know how you feel about cement players like Ambuja, like ACC right now. But pricing power has returned to a certain extent. We've seen some solidity there. But on the other side, also, you've got to consider input costs. And over there, like Piyush was mentioning, petco prices are down around 14 to 15%. Diesel prices are down around 2%. And you're looking at it on a year-on-year basis. Do you think some of these factors, plus the government's push towards infra, could really help the cement pack? How would you rate an Ambuja right now, whose earnings we are expected?
Yeah. See, naturally, after the infra, cement will start doing better, that's for sure. Whenever infra capex start, they will be beneficiary, that's again a positive. But the key thing when looking to the stocks are, you know, the kind of cost pressure they had, that is reduced, which is the best positive for it. The pricing power has not come, you know, very largely favoring them, but at least the pricing pressure is absent. The pricing pressure is absent. The cost is, you know, improving, so the margin surely will expand, that is sure. Demand, whenever it comes, will start, you know, creating good amount of bad growth for them. In the meanwhile, it's better in my mind to buy something which is a pan-India player or something, you know, more focused on the Andhra market or something where the demand trajectory is a little better than the overall space. In terms of pan-India, I think Ultratech is one name which we are like liking a lot. There would be 20% PAT growth this year. The ROE is smoothly increasing for the company. And continuously we have seen they are bringing down their cost. So that's one name where we are more comfortable with. But having said that, most of the cement name, they'll be low beta companies. So if you are bearish about the market, it's a good place to, you know, go and hide because they'll not be falling the way you get scared with a lot of, you know, high beta names. So good place to hide also. Plus, whenever the traction comes in infra capex, it could be in the second half or the early calendar year next. That will be good name to good sector to bet upon. Okay. Ultratech is our choice.
All right, Shailendra, thanks a lot. We seem to have run out of time right here. Thank you so much for joining us for this conversation on Markets Midday. Shailendra Kumar, Director, Narnolia Financial Advisors, joining us right here on Markets Midday and really taking us through the sort of detailed analysis that we require as investors right there. Thank you for that. Let's also talk to you about the latest when it comes to a top story that we are tracking right here. This is lenders and